Good morning. Welcome to Hope Christian Church. We're going to start off by singing some praise. And this is a song that we've sung here before. I think it's been a little while, but it's called Yes, I Will. And it's a commitment song that no matter what's going on in our life out there throughout the week or even on Sundays, you know, to whatever is outside of these four walls, it doesn't matter as far as my commitment to, I'm going to choose to praise God, praise Jesus through no matter what. So go ahead and stand up with us and sing along. Dear God, thank you so much for being the God that is worthy of all of our praise. And you are there when we need help. You are there always for us. And I just want to thank you and help us to choose to praise you no matter what's going on. There's lots of good things going on. There's lots of bad things going on always. And you are the same through it all. So just thank you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You guys can be seated. We're going to turn it over to Dave, who's going to pray for our offering this week.
Good morning. Good morning. Oh, we can do better than that. You got to wake up. Good morning. Good morning. Oh, that's a whole lot better. God is so good. I'm telling you, if you were here last night, it was our annual auction for the youth teen camp coming up. And, you know, sometimes you think, hey, I don't know how it's going to do. It did better than any other year we've ever had because God is good. Yes, he's so good. And I tell you, prayer is powerful because before it started, we just said, we're going to give thanks for what God's going to do tonight. And God did it. So that's an awesome thing. We're looking forward to teen camp and how God ministers in those ways. Hey, there's some things coming up I want to remind you of. If you're part of Hope Christian Church, we exist to share hope. All right. Half of y'all got that. Let's do it one more time. We exist to share. All right, yes. And the way you can do that is share the love of Jesus. So does anybody know, I'm really going to try to give you a hint here, what's coming up in a couple weeks that's big in the religious world? Passover. Yeah. So Easter service is coming up. So there's these cards out there, and they just have the sermon titles on them. And we all have a responsibility. When we know Jesus, our responsibility is to make sure somebody else knows Jesus. And so make sure you pick one of those up and invite somebody. Also, if you're kind of new here to the church, if you will come to Welcome to the Church on the Hill next week, right after worship service, we feed you, talk a little bit about what the church is about. You get to meet the staff and the elders and so forth. And so there's sign-up sheets out here by this door and out here by that door. We'd love to have you come out for that. And, of course, our conference, we're excited about that. It's coming up. And so you need to go ahead and register for that conference. And it's not just for leaders. It's for anyone. You all will be blessed by it. And so check that out and make sure you come out for that. But, you know, God is so good. Oh, another thing. Before Easter, we've got this chore list. It's right there. And if you want to help out with some of the chores, all you got to do is you can pick up one of those, see what you're interested in, call in here to the church office, and we can make sure we get some things done before Easter. But, you know, God blesses us all the time, and our blessings are meant to be a blessing to others. No matter what kind of blessing it is, you were blessed to be a blessing. And so each week we have the opportunity to worship through our giving, and we're thankful for that because then God takes what we give and he ministers to other people. And so there's different ways that you can see where you can give, whether it be by texting, whether on the church app or on the website, or as you're leaving today, the bags will be out there for the receiving the offering. And so we want to go to God in prayer right now and give him thanks for the offering that we're going to receive and ask for wisdom as we spend those monies for his glory. Father, you are so good. Lord, we woke up today to a beautiful day. It's springtime, and we thank you for your love for us. God, you provide for us all the time. And even though you never promised that we would become materially wealthy or anything like that, you did promise you would provide for us, and you do, and we thank you. And so, God, as people are giving to God, to you, I pray for wisdom for those of us who are to make the decisions how those funds are to be spent. God, may we always remember this is your money. This is your church. And we want to do the right thing so that others can hear the gospel, the needy can be helped. And so, God, we give you thanks for what you do through your offerings. And, God, we just want to give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's rise back up to our feet and continue to worship our awesome God who is so worthy of our praise.
Amen. In Mark chapter 4, Jesus is on a boat with his disciples. And it says this starting in verse 37. A great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat so that the boat was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said to them, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" And when we read stories like that, sometimes the challenge is, what do I get out of that? How do I apply that to my life so that I can be a better follower of Jesus? And I've always looked at that story, at Jesus calms the storm. The storms of life come, you know, and we have difficult things, and Jesus calms that storm. But I think an even better story, moral to take away from it, is Jesus doesn't always calm the storm going on out there. But Jesus calms the storm in here, in my heart. It gives me the inner peace that people really want. It comes from Jesus and only from Jesus. So I can always think back on that story and other stories and other experiences that I've had when something happens and think, God, you are so good and you've proven over and over again how much you care for us and how the peace and the joy that you give us when we follow you. And I know you're going to do it again. And we're going to sing a song about that right now, so join us as we sing. are going to sing a song.
Faithfulness.
Can you look back in your life and see things, stuff that God has done? Yeah, give him a round of applause for what he does and continues to do for us. I want to sing, we've done this song before too, but it's fairly new. Next step, when we have that, you know, relationship with God, we want to tell people about it. And this song is called Somebody Needs to Hear. And since it's been a little while since we've done this, I want to kind of help you learn how the song goes so you can sing along. So it's pretty simple. And here's the first verse. Somebody needs to hear the gospel of our God. Somebody needs to hear the good news of our Lord. I'm gonna tell somebody. I'm gonna tell somebody what Jesus has done for me. 'Cause somebody needs to hear. Sing along with us. Somebody needs to hear the gospel of our God. Somebody needs to hear the good news of our Lord. I'm gonna tell somebody. I'm gonna tell somebody what Jesus has done for me. 'Cause somebody needs to hear. Are you ready? Somebody needs to hear the gospel of our God. Oh yeah, somebody needs to hear the good news of our Lord. I'm gonna tell somebody. I'm gonna tell somebody what Jesus has done for me. Somebody needs to hear. Sometimes I need to hear the gospel of our God. Oh yes, sometimes I need to hear the good news of our Lord. So I'm gonna read about it, and I'm gonna pray about it, what Jesus has done for me. Sometimes I need to hear. In this world of darkness, we need a burning lamp. Somebody needs the truth, so somebody needs to share. Well, who might need to hear the gospel of our God? Well, who might need to hear of our Lord? Will you tell somebody? Will you tell somebody what Jesus has done for you? Somebody needs to hear. In this world of darkness, we need a burning lamp. Somebody needs the truth, so somebody needs to share. Somebody needs to hear the gospel of our God. Oh yes, somebody needs to hear the good news of our Lord. I'm gonna tell somebody. I'm gonna tell somebody what Jesus has done for me. Somebody needs to hear what Jesus has done for me. Somebody needs to hear. Amen. Dear God, thank you for being worthy of all of our efforts, and ask that you help us, give us boldness to talk to people about you. Be with Dave right now as he is about to give us a message from your word. Help us to soak in the truth from your word that he brings us this morning. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You guys can be seated.
Man, Easter, as I said, is a perfect time
to reach out to people, to share the opportunity of Jesus with them. And you know, this world is hungry for something. They are hungry for something. And so it'd be a good time, definitely, to reach out and to let them know that Jesus loves them, just inviting them to come and worship on an Easter. And sometimes God just opens that door. I did a funeral for someone here a couple weeks ago, and so I told the guy whom I knew previously, and I was standing there, I said, hey, if you're ever in the Augusta area on 10 o'clock on Sunday mornings, come on up. And he looked at his wife and said, we were just wondering where we're going to go to church on Easter. And I'm like, all right. So, you know, when it gets like the week before, I'm going to be texting this guy and say, hey, don't forget Easter's here. So what an opportunity we have. Hey, and I want to ask you sincerely this. Isn't God great? Yeah. All right, let's give God a hand clap of praise. He is. And I don't say that just to get you juiced up. It's the truth, but we often forget about him. And I love it when I'm driving in or driving somewhere and I see God's creation. I just have to say, like, God, you are so awesome. And that helps pick up my spirits. Even though I'm having a bad day, it helps pick up my spirits and gets me in the mindset of worship. Bob Russell, who will be coming to be our guest speaker, and I've often said when you meet Bob Russell, you know, the church where he started in the 60s was 200, grew over up to 20,000 in Louisville, Kentucky, and I'll tell you, I've said it time and time again, probably when you meet him, unless you know, except for I'm giving you the heads up, he's not going to be what you expect. He's this humble guy, but man, when he speaks, he is right on, but just a real humble guy. But then his book, he talks about worship, and he says this, that worship should have two big experiences. One is joy, when we come together and lift up an awesome God, and the other is reverence. And both of those things need to happen in our worship. And sometimes we sit there and act like, gee, I'm in church, I can't move. I'm like, you got every reason to move, man, because our God is worthy of our praise. And so we're just glad that we can praise him today. You know, it's always good to have guests with us. We have guests pretty much every Sunday, and so we're thankful to have you here. And also, I'd like to give a heads up to them that if you're looking for the perfect church with perfect people, spoiler alert, this is not it, okay? It's not it. I mean, we are all broken. And once we realize how broken we really are, then God can use us to help others who are broken. So no matter who we are, we're just on a journey to see Jesus. We're on a journey to grow to be more like him. And that's what we want you, if you're saying, like, sounds like me, then welcome. Welcome as we try to grow to be with Jesus. And I hope that we, as Hope Christian Church, never forget that we don't come in here just to sit. We come in here to serve one another. Our job on Sunday as we're getting ready is to say, God, who can I encourage today? And maybe it's a smile, it's a handshake, whatever it is, who can I encourage? I got a job when I come in here, and that is, part of it is to make folks know that I'm glad they're here too. And so that is our job. So stand up, turn to someone, and just say, hi. Jesus gives. But before I go into the sermon, I just saw something, so I need to do this because I've been thinking about it for a couple weeks. Because the Bible says, talks about prayer, and we want to be a church who's serious about prayer. And one of the things that a lot of times it says, pray for our governing officials. And I'm sitting there, I'm going like, we got two guys here in our church, and we've never really prayed over them. And so I'm going to ask Bob and Brian if they'll come up. They're our county commissioners. And I know, you can say, I don't always agree with them. That's okay. My wife doesn't agree with me 95% of the time. And we're still married. But anyway, I asked them to come up because I want to pray over them. And I'm going to ask our elders to come up. I believe in the power of prayer. And one of the things that we could say about these guys is at least they give of their best moral thinking to try to make decisions. We're not all going to agree on everything. But the Bible says, let's pray. Let's pray. And we appreciate what they do. And so we're going to come up. And then I'm going to ask Paul, if you would. Paul's making his way over. Paul Crawford, if you would, to have prayer over these guys. And we appreciate them and love them. And I know some people ask if they're crazy for taking this job. I remember one guy asking Bob that. He said, I thought you lost your mind when you ran again. So it is a tough job. So we want to have a moment. All of us pray for him. And then Paul Crawford will lead us in prayer.
Father God, I want to give you thanks for your people here as we come together and focus our thoughts and minds to giving over praise to you and to lifting up these men here who, I almost said young men.
One of them.
I tell you what, we want to lift these men up who serve you here in our county.
Yes.
And it's not an easy thing in so many cases. They suffer a lot of the slings and arrows in their position that we don't even often see or hear or understand. And sometimes in their stand as Christians for you, they receive threats. They receive people getting in their face and cussing them out and yelling at them. And so it's not an easy job doing what they do.
That's right.
And especially not easy when they're Christians and taking a stand in your name for the things that they know are right, Lord God. And so we just want to pray for them and lift them up.
Yes.
And so just be with Bob and Brian and just help them, Lord. Strengthen them. Let them know that you are with them.
Yes.
And that we are behind them, Lord God. You don't always have to agree with everything they do and say, but Lord God, we pray for them and for their families,
yes.
For protection and for guidance. Just fill them with your Holy Spirit, Lord God. Set up a hedge around them and just let them know that they're loved and that we encourage them to continue to be faithful lights and beacons in this community
yes.
for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Love you guys.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Now, somebody say, is it church practicing politics? Oh, that drives me nuts. I'm like, no, we're supposed to pray for our leaders, and that's what God calls us to do. And it's been on my heart. And like one week, one of them wanted to be here, and everyone, I was like, and I looked out somewhere, like, oh, they're both here. We are going to pray. So I appreciate these guys and their stands they take. And so just wanted to stop my sermon right there and put that out there. But we're in this new series called In Troubled Times, Jesus Gives. In Troubled Times, Jesus gives. You know, Paul Crawford here met his wife Toni before they were married there, and he looked at her and he said, oh my goodness, she's pretty. She can cook. She can do chores. And man, she's a little feisty. I need to marry this girl because my life will be set. It will be set. I don't have to do anything. You know, I can just relax and chill. And so they get married and they decided they're going to take the, y'all see the look Tony's giving me right now. Her arms are crossed like, what is he going to say? Anyway, they decide they're going to take the horse and wagon out to the farm. And so they're riding along and Paul's just sitting back thinking, Tony's like, I'll drive. I'll drive. And Paul's like, man, this is the life. I'm telling you, they can't get any better than this. And he's relaxing there, and the old horse stumbles a little bit. And Tony said, that's once. And so Paul's just sitting back. He's just enjoying life. And they go a good bit further, and the horse, it stumbles again. And Paul's just sitting there relaxing, thinking this is life. And that old horse stumbles again. Tony said, that's twice. And so Paul, he doesn't say anything. He's just sitting back here chilling. They almost get to the farm, and the old horse stumbles again. And Tony pulls a gun out from underneath the seat, shoots the horse. Paul says, hey, what in the world was that about? That's a little crazy. That wasn't necessary. And Tony said, that's once. Sometimes we see, Tony, you like that one. Yeah, yeah. Paul's trying to behave because he's sitting right in front of Tony. And man, the punishment he could get. So anyway, we don't know what's actually happening sometimes in our lives and what comes upon us. And so, you know, I know a lot of times when you see me up here, you're like, you know, Dave's always smiling. Dave's always upbeat. Dave, you know, when you ever come in, like, he's got it all together. No. There's some days when I come in to preach, trust me, Satan works on me. You know, and sometimes there's things on my heart, things on my mind, whether they're family things or whether I don't feel good or whether there's something going on in the ministry, because I'm just like you. I have struggles just like you. I mess up, I make mistakes, and I need the mercy of God. And so
We all have these troubles. And there's sometimes I even question, God, why? Why, God? Why is this? And our world has kind of really stepped off the deep end lately. You know, I don't know, you've had to notice this. You know, all my adult life, I've never seen anything as crazy as what we're dealing with now. And mainly because it's evil. That's why. When you're sitting there like, I can't figure this out, it makes no sense. And that's what evil does. But anyway, as we're thinking about this, I know that right now while I'm speaking, there's some of y'all within the hearing of my voice, whether right here personally or online when they listen a little bit later, you're going through struggles right now. There's some things going on in your life that is causing some pain and some issues or some struggles out there. And so today our message is this: in troubled times, Jesus gives peace. Jesus gives peace. Even that word makes us go, peace. So we'll be reading from the book of Mark this morning. We're going to start in chapter 4. Chapter 4, I invite you to follow along, and because when you do this, it allows God's Spirit to minister to you through His Word. When you follow along, and sometimes He reveals to you things that I didn't say, but things that you get through the Word. So before we begin, let's go to God and ask for His direction this morning. Lord, we thank You for the day. It's been a beautiful day, and we thank You for that. And God, even though the world seems crazy and out of control, we know that You're still in control. And nothing happens without You being in control. And Lord, as we look at these scriptures today, I pray that You just kind of remove me from the scene. I am not, You know me, God, and You know I'm not that perfect person. You know the struggles I have, but yet I ask Your Holy Spirit to speak and minister to all of us so that we can grow together on this journey. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So as we begin to read this morning, we got to picture this, that Jesus has been busy. You know, I think maybe sometimes we forget that Jesus is also human. Not only is He God, He is human. And if one of the things that I think watching the Chosen is, sometimes they do a good job depicting that He is also in a human body. And so He's had this long day. He's been teaching and telling the message to people. And so the crowd grows large, and He gets into a boat and even speaks from the boat because the crowd is very large. And this makes a long day for Him, and He's very tired. So here's what I want you to do this morning. I want you to put yourself in this story. You are one of the disciples this morning, okay? Picture this. You're following this Jesus. You haven't been there too long, but you're following Him, and you're in the group there, and maybe you're excited because here's the Messiah. You know He's the Messiah, and you're excited because people are showing up, and He's teaching, but Jesus is tired. He's weary because when you put a lot into your teaching, it does something to you. It drains you physically, emotionally, and you just kind of, And so this is where Jesus is. And so here we go. You're in the story. Matthew 4, 35 and 36. That day, when evening came, He said to His disciples, "Let's go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took Him along just as He was in the boat. And there were also other boats with Him. So, as the day drew to a close, Jesus was looking for some rest and peace. Some rest and peace. Doesn't that sound nice? What was He looking for? Yeah, some rest. But you've had one of those days, but now you're here. You've seen it. It's been a dizzy day, a busy day, and you and the other disciples are there, and so He's worn out, and I believe that Jesus has just been giving His all and He's teaching. And so as you put the boats out into the sea, and Jesus begins to lay His head down on this cushion, and you're out there in the water, and He hears the water slush. And you know, it's like when you sometimes, if you like, you're by a creek or something, you're sitting back, and you're hearing the water just trickling down, and yes, you're resting. And so you're in the boat, and Jesus gets back there, and it's just kind of rocking Him to sleep. He feels the breeze coming across Him, and then that boat is rocking, and you know, probably He's sitting there sort of thinking about the day as He finally just goes off into sleep. And He needs that rest. But then we want to look down here just a little bit further, okay? Mark 4, 37 to 38, as you're in this boat with Jesus. And here we go. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. And Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. And the disciples woke Him and said, "Teacher, don't you care if we drowned?" So, suddenly, they were in rest and peace, and now it's disturbed by trouble. By trouble, what is it? Trouble. See, Jesus is asleep in the boat. You and your other disciples, you're talking amongst yourselves about the day, how great it's been. You're actually so excited. Have you ever been there where you're so tired, but you're so excited about what's happened, you can't sleep? You know, you ever had to have, I remember when I was in youth ministry, that's the way teen camp a lot of times was for me. At nighttime after worship, I'd be like shot, dead tired, but yet there's so much excitement going on that you really can't sleep. So here you are, you're in this boat, and you're talking about the day, and you're thinking about Jesus, and he's sleeping there, and so then finally you start nodding off and everything, and you know, things are going along nice and calm. And then James says, "Do you feel that? You feel that?" Andrew says, "Yeah, I feel it." And the next thing you know, you're in a full-blown storm. You're like, whoa, what happened? You see, the Sea of Galilee was known for these sudden storms, fierce storms. And these tempests are caused because of where the sea sits down here. And then there's mountains around, and the cold air comes down and meets that warm air. I sound like a meteorologist now, don't I? Anyway, it comes down and meets it. And so when that warm air and cold air collide, you've got this storm going on. You have this storm happening, and it happens suddenly. David Shearscough writes this in an article from Israel Today. Anyone who visits the Eastern Galilee in the summer gets to know the afternoon breeze that blows inland from the Mediterranean Sea from about 1 o'clock to 8 p.m. He said, I have seen it fan brush fires and overturned shade umbrellas, but this pleasant afternoon airflow could hardly be translated from the Greek as the way the disciples talk about it. When they talk about a gale force storm or a fierce storm or heavy squall or furious squall. And so I wondered, did the writers of the New Testament exaggerate some? But then on Saturday night, as I tried to sleep, a windstorm threatened to blow anything, everything, but the concrete house itself. And when I woke up the following morning, I half expected the sheds in the yard would be knocked over. Luckily, they were protected from the wind by a stone wall. The boardwalk of the Tiberius was not so lucky there. The winds whipped large waves on the Sea of Galilee. They wreaked havoc on the boardwalk, flooding dozens of shops and restaurants near the water. And so he is saying that this beautiful sea can quickly become treacherous. And that's what's happened. And so you get nervous. You're in the boat with Jesus, and you start getting nervous when you see this happening. And you see Peter and Andrew and some of the other disciples who were professional fishermen, remember, fearing for their lives. So you go over and you look at Jesus like, should I try to wake him up or what? You know, because what's going on? And finally, another one of the disciples walks over because you're wondering, how's Jesus sleeping? The water's coming in the boat. You know, the mist is coming up on him and spraying him. How in the world is he still sleeping? And so you hang on to the edge of the boat, contemplating whether you're going to wake Jesus up or not. And then one of the other guys said, wake him up. He's going to drown. He'll be thrown overboard, and he's going to drown. And so they wake him up, and they're like, hey, doesn't this bother you? We're all going to drown out here. So Mark 4:39, he got up, and he rebuked the wind and said to the waves, quiet, be still. Then the wind died down. It was completely calm. Whew, that's amazing, isn't it? Come on, you're in this boat. Now, I can't swim. I know what I'd be in that boat. Man, I'd be like, get him up. Of course, we got to talk about that here in a little bit too. But anyway, yeah, I'd be freaking out, you know, because, and so here's these, I'm like, you're a professional fisherman. You've been in the sea an awful lot, and you're freaking out? I'm going to freak out, okay? I usually don't freak out too easy, but I can't swim. So anyway, here it is. You're just glad that there is calm. But then it sets in, and you know, the storm has just, wait a minute. That storm just listened to him. The storm just listened to him. He spoke. You know, you look at the other disciples like, did y'all notice that? Who is this guy that when he speaks, they don't know it yet. When he speaks, you know, the storms listen. And your life is like a roller coaster. You were in trouble. But now, again, you are enjoying rest and peace. What is it? Yeah. The storm is quieted, and it's peaceful. You're just out there on the lake, and it's peaceful. You and the others are still amazed that Jesus just calmed a sea by speaking to it. But then Mark 5, verse 1, then he went across the lake to the region of the Gerasenes. So here we are again. Rest and peace. Say it. Yeah. You see the shore, and when you pull up on the shore, you want to kiss the ground. Because even though that thing has calmed down, you're like, I am so thankful to be back on shore. And so you're like, yes, this is peaceful. But here we go, Mark 5, 2 through 5. When Jesus got out of the boat, a man with an impure spirit came from the tombs to meet him. And this man lived in the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain. For he had often been chained hand and foot, but he tore the chains and broke apart the irons of his feet. And no one was strong enough to subdue him. Night and day among the tombs in the hills, he would cry out and cry out himself and cut himself with stones. Okay, you gotta be kidding me now, right, Jesus? Come on now. I mean, here we are. You know, we were following you and we thought all was rest and peace. And then here it is. Now it's trouble. What is it? Yeah, it's trouble. I mean, we landed somewhere, and I thought, my goodness, whew, we're finally safe, right? And so we're close to the tombs here, but hey, that's not necessarily bad, except here comes this crazy guy. I'm talking, he's a lunatic, man. He's a lunatic. And you're like, who is this man? I cannot believe this. Really? This is going on? And is this what following the Messiah is like? Get that, okay? Is this what it's all about? And so we're in the middle of this demon possession thing going on here. This is really spooky. Now, I know that Matthew says that there were two men, and Mark and Luke only mention one man. And I know in Matthew's defense, if I've studied it right, Matthew was really the only eyewitness of those three anyway, I think. Unless y'all find something different. He was the one that was there. He was one of the followers that was there. And so that doesn't mean that one's wrong and the other's wrong. It could be that the one guy, you will read, came down and said, Jesus, I want to follow you. And that could have been who they really focused on. And so, you know, and these letters are written some 20 or 30 years later, and they're by witnesses. And if you went to, have you ever been somewhere and somebody was at the same event you were, and when you told the story, you were telling it true, and they told it true, but yet it sounded a little bit different? Yeah, because they saw something different than you did. They experienced something different, something stuck in their mind, maybe even because of something in their past. And so that's one of the cool things about God's Word. When people say, look, if I want to make up a story, it's going to be detailed and everything is going to jive. When you're trying to put together pieces of a true story, you get different pieces everywhere. So that's what I love about God's Word. It doesn't say it's false. It makes me know that it must be real because of this. So anyway, let's get out of that and let's keep on going. So as we look, this is freaky, all right? This is really freaky. How many of y'all would like to be in this part right here with this demon-possessed guy? Is this like freaking out and going wild? But anyway, as we look at this, you had the terrible storm, and now you got this demon possession going on, and this guy is a maniac, and we realize that. And so it says here in verses 6 through 15 in Mark chapter 5, when he saw Jesus from a distance, he ran and fell on his knees in front of him. And he shouted at the top of his voice, what do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In God's name, don't torture me. He knew Jesus was, didn't he? That evil spirits knew who Jesus was. Some translations say he worshiped him. And I'm thinking, wow, that's kind of amazing. But he fell at his feet. Jesus had said, come out of this man, you impure spirit. And then Jesus asked him, what is your name? My name is Legion, he replied, for we are many. And he began to beg Jesus again and again not to send them out into this area. And a large herd of pigs was feeding on the nearby hillside. And the demons begged Jesus, send us into those pigs. I'm like, you kidding me? That's a lot of ham right there you're going to ruin, you know. But anyway, they're like, send us into those pigs. And he gave them permission. And the impure spirits came out and went into the pigs. The herd was about 2,000 in number. And they rushed down the steep bank into the lake and were drowned. And those tending the pigs ran off and reported this to the town and countryside. And the people went out to see what had happened. And when they came to Jesus, they saw the man who had been possessed by the legion of demons sitting there dressed in his right mind. And they were afraid. Now, townspeople might have been afraid, but I'm thinking, this guy's sitting there dressed, because actually he was not dressed, we can keep clothes on, and he was dressed and he was in his right mind. And this scared the townspeople. And so once again, as Jesus calmed everything down, his disciples, you right there, you're experiencing rest and peace. Say it one more time. Rest and peace. Following Jesus when he walked on this earth was an adventure. wasn't it? I mean, really, it was an adventure. You never knew what was coming next. But if we follow Jesus today, our lives should be an adventure. They should. If we're really looking how where Jesus is leading us, and I believe that Jesus speaks to us today. My grandson, Wyatt, who's 7 years old, and he in his school lesson there, they were talking about Elijah, and we got talking about a prophet and God speaking, and I said, God even speaks to you. And he looked at me kind of funny. I said, it's not in that voice, but you know, have you ever had that little thought? Don't do this. This is not right. Now, that little rascal, you got to know him, okay? Because he's not going to actually admit when, he's kind of stubborn. And I would say, tell Danielle, turn that stubbornness into a good way, and you got a good, strong person. And so he's looking at me. I said, huh? You ever hear that voice? Like, I'm not supposed to do this, but I think I'm going to do it anyway. Yeah, but you're not supposed to do this. And he's sitting there, he's grinning at me like, yeah, I've heard that voice, you know? And I said, that's God speaking to you. That's God through his spirit speaking to you. He's ministering to your heart. That's God speaking to you. When we follow Jesus today, it should be an adventure. Go over and speak to that person. Go pray with that person. You know, when you're tuned into Jesus, you get that, okay? You'll get, go take food to that person. Stop right now and pray for this person. But are we sometimes too busy? We're not really following Jesus. We're like, hey, there goes Gene. Hey, I like you, Jesus. Hey, good going your journey there. And so in our lives, it's tough because I pray, God, help me to be on mission every day because I know you've got something for me. And a lot of times I miss it because I'm not on mission. And so you might be asking, so Dave, how does this help me with a quest for peace? You know, I've just put myself back into the years ago where I was a disciple. So here it is. I mean, I think looking at these scriptures right here, the best thing that we can do, the most important thing we can take for this is learn from the master. Just learn from the master. Say that with me. Learn from the master. Now say it and think about it. Learn from the master. So what do I mean? Sometimes we're kind of slow at getting the point. You know what I'm saying? You ever been like that? I know God has to look at me like, how much longer, Dave? You know, when Jesus would say to his disciples, I have been with you all these years and you still don't get it. You know, and I know God looks at me like, Dave, I've been with you all these years and you still don't get it. I know. Okay, here I go. Thank you for your mercy and patience, God. So anyway, we sometimes don't get the point. My friend Scott Gold, I got to tell you, Scott told me today, we stand outside the front door, and Scott's like, Dave, I just got to say that most people know my name, even though I don't know theirs, because of you. He said, because he's always in my jokes. But Scott Gold was going through a divorce, and the divorce court lawyer said, Mr. Gold, after reviewing everything carefully, I have decided that I am going to give your wife $775 a week. And Scott says, that seems very fair. And every now and then, I'll try to give her a few bucks. Sometimes we don't get it, you know. We kind of miss it, even in Scripture. And so, you know, we want to be clear to understand what is it that we can learn and will help us to find peace in our troubled lives. I referred to this earlier in The Chosen, in the first season there, Peter, how they depicted him, you know, is he, which you can kind of see in his personality if you ever watch the show, but he's got himself in some trouble. He needs to pay some taxes. And one of the phrases, I think he says it to his wife that he uses is, I've got this. And we need to learn from this event that we shouldn't say, I've got this. We need to learn to say, Jesus has this. Jesus has this. And as a church, I'm trying to get me to do it, that when something is coming up, we go ahead and praise God for what he is going to do because Jesus has it. Dave don't have it. You don't have it. Jesus has it. It's not, I've got this. No, Jesus has this. And when Jesus calmed the storm, look at what he asked. In Mark 4:40, he said to his disciples, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? I believe that when the disciples were waking him up, they weren't really waking him up to do a miracle because you kind of look at their response later. They like, who is this guy? I just think that they were waking him up so they would all be together trying to figure out what they were going to do. And so I think they're thinking, you're going to die right along with us here. Come on, don't you even care? And so They didn't know the power that Jesus really had yet. They didn't get it. Because look at this verse in 41, Mark 4:41. They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this that the winds and the waves obey him?" In other words, who are we in the presence of? Even though they were like, "This is the Messiah," I get that. Even though they'd seen him do some miracles, all of a sudden you're one of those disciples, and you're like, "Wow, who are we in the presence of that all he did was speak and these waves calmed down and the winds went still? Who is he that can do such great things?" You know, it's plain to see that they were totally surprised at Jesus' power. But then there's something that we need to take away from this account. When we're going through struggles in our life, when we're going through struggles and our lives are full of turmoil, and yes, it happens. It happens. Some people wonder why, but this is a good person. Why does something bad happen to them? I want to tell you that you don't need to keep searching your life going like, "It must be my fault. I wasn't living good enough, and this happened to my mom, or this happened to my dad, this happened to my child." No, no, no. Not necessarily so. The Bible says that the rain falls on the good and the bad, the just and the unjust, because life stinks, all right? I'm just going to say it. Here's what happened. God creates the heavens and the earth. He puts mankind in here. And what's mankind do? We look to evil. And once evil entered the world is corrupted, okay? So bad junk can happen to good people. Bad junk can happen to good people. Don't beat yourself up saying, "God, what did I do? How did I make it?" We're all sinners. But, you know, here's the point. Not until we reach heaven we'll be perfect again. And there'll be no pain, there'll be no sorrow, there'll be none of this junk. Because God's like, "I'm going to make a new heaven and a new earth. And there's not going to be any sin in it." Satan and his demons would be cast into the pits of hell. And if you go to hell, it's because you followed Satan there. That's all I'm saying. God didn't send you there, okay? I want you to get that clear. He's like, "Come here, the door's open, get in here. You're like, "Huh, what, you know?" And you're following Satan. No, God's like, "Don't go that way. That's for Satan and his angels. Come in here, the door's open." That's our God. That's how awesome he is. And so when we're going through struggles and turmoil, we got to remember who Jesus is. Jesus showed that he had the power to overcome nature. First of all, right there, when he calmed the storm. I mean, he could speak. And it just got quiet. I mean, that would freak you out, wouldn't it? When we're in a boat with this guy, he just spoke, and this happened? Whoa. But then, he also showed that he has control over the supernatural when he met this demon-possessed person. Possessed with all these demons, and no one else could come. But the words of Jesus. Again, it was always the words. And the Word was God, and the Word was with God, John says. And nothing was made without him. Everything that was made by him and for him. And so, for us, true peace starts to come when we begin to know Jesus. In your life, I'm not saying, and I'll go on this, I'm not saying that he's going to calm every storm, as Jason mentioned there. But I'm telling you, if you follow Jesus, I'm not going to stand up here and say, "Like, you will not have any problems. You will not have any problems at all if today you'll give your life to Jesus." As a matter of fact, I will say this. If you follow Jesus, you're going to have some problems, all right? That's what I'm going to say. Because Satan doesn't like it when you follow Jesus. He doesn't. I mean, the only way that he can ever do, he's got this grudge against God. God kicked his rear end out of heaven, man. And so he's like, "I'm going to get him back. I'm going after him. I'm going to have a kingdom." And so he wants us. Not because he loves us, but he wants to use us against the Father. And so you're going to have trouble when you become a Christian. But just look at these disciples. You know, they were following Jesus right into trouble. In other words, Jesus didn't keep them out of trouble. It was Jesus who said, "Let's get in a boat and let's go to the other side." It was Jesus there who got up on the shore. You get it? They were following Jesus right into the trouble. But also, they were following him into the peace. Into the peace. And in your life, when troubled things happen, remember that Jesus is there. You see, there was a song, an old gospel song years ago, that said this: "Sometimes he calms the storm, and sometimes he calms me." You ever been there? Sometimes he calms that storm, but sometimes that storm is still out there, but he calms me. He calms my spirit. You know, some of us, or some of you who has driven large vehicles, Mike Krause can vouch for this, and that wind is blowing, and when you're driving that large vehicle and that wind's blowing it, you have to steer into that wind. You have to steer in that wind. I noticed that when our family would travel and sing in our bus and I'd be driving and the wind would be blowing, you got to kind of steer into it to keep her on the road. I remember one time we were going to make a recording and my brother Mark was driving, and everybody always looks at Mark and goes like, he's the quiet one. Oh yeah, but don't let him fool you. So anyway, he's driving. He's moving along pretty good. That wind's blowing. And my sisters, who are always back there, always had their ideas, you know, my sisters. So anyway, they were like, told Dad, said, tell Mark to slow down. The wind's blowing too hard. Mark said, it ain't going to blow any slower if I slow down, so I'm keeping on going. So, but you got to kind of steer into the wind. Joel Hemphill, who's a gospel artist and songwriter, and he tells it when his family group one night was traveling, and they came across this storm, and the rain was pouring down, and the wind was just beating like crazy, and you could feel that wind blowing against their bus. And while this was happening, these words came to Joel Hemphill. I know the master of the wind. I know the maker of the rain. He can calm your storm, make the sun shine again. I know the master of the wind. That's the words he wrote. And so I want you to notice something. That here's what I look at and say this. Peace is not what happens around you. Peace is what happens in you. Peace is not what happens around you. Peace is what happens in you. This is what Jesus gives. As we're growing closer to Easter, I just want to focus a lot on Jesus. He has the answers for our life. He never promised, as I said, that he would keep everything calm around us. But when we begin to know him better, we realize that he gives us peace inside. He gives us peace inside. He is in the storm with you. He is in the storm with you. You know, as we're planning to close out here, I just want to leave us with this thought here, that Jesus never leaves us or forsakes us. But some of y'all remember Trish, who came here to worship with us. And Trish, very pretty young lady, always at the door as a guest minister, greeting, smiling. And Trish gets cancer, and she goes in for treatments, and she comes back out, and, you know, she's beat the cancer, and things are good, and she's back out smiling, and she's back out greeting. You know, when you look at her life, you're just seeing, she's a very pleasant person. And then cancer comes back. And we're praying for her and praying for her. And so this struggle is going on in her life. And then finally they say, there's nothing else we can do. This cancer has grown too large. And Trish, I can't remember, about 40 years old at that time. And like I said, you look at her and she was always healthy other than this. But I remember the day after she came back from that doctor and they said, there's nothing else we can do. And I remember walking into her house and Trish looked at me, pretty young lady. And she looks at me and she says, Dave, her voice cracks up. And she says, will you do my funeral? You know, I'm sitting there going like, wow. You know, I'm like 20 years older than you and you're asking me to do this. I said, Trish, it'd be my honor to do that. You see, that storm is still going around Trish. And I went over many times and visited. And I'm not going to tell you that she didn't have questions. She's a human being. And I remember her right before she passed away said, I said, Trish, is there anything you want to talk about? You know that God loves you. You know. She said, I know. She said, there's a little bit of something here that wants me to hold on there. Well, I understand that. You got two sons. You got a husband. You got a family. I can understand that. The storm was still going around Trish, but the peace was inside. That's the kind of peace you want, isn't it? Yeah, because you're going to have storms. I remember going to Baltimore University Hospital quite a few years ago because I had a pheochromocytoma, a tumor on my adrenaline gland. And my thoughts were going, and they didn't know exactly for sure, usually they're not cancerous, you know, my thoughts are going this. What about my wife and my young kids? And then I think back and go like, I know that's a natural thing, it's how we do, but I'm thinking, I guess I'm saying, God, I can take care of them better than you can. We all have that lack of faith sometimes. 38 years old, a young man, very godly man, was once in the ministry, then became an elder and did carpenter work, and he got cancer. 38 years old, he dies. Two young kids. But God worked and took care of those kids. Both of them still love the Lord, still serve the Lord. But I also remember at this guy's dad's funeral when Tim's son spoke. And he asked his granddad one time, "Why are you watching over me so much? Why did you step in?" He said, "Because your daddy made me promise that I would take care of you and have a godly man in your life." God prepares those things too. This morning, whatever struggles you're going through, God knows. Jesus is in the boat with you, okay? He's on the shore when that demon-possessed guy is there. But you know Jesus. He has the power over all these things. This life is going to end one day or another for us. Don't like to talk about it. But when you know Jesus, oh, that new life, oh, there's no worries. And today, if you don't know him, you can't do anything that'll make God stop loving you. I don't care what you've done. I don't care what your past is. Forget a lie from Satan. God's saying, the door's open. The door's open. Come on. I'm not going to force you, but the door is open. Come on. And so today, that door is open for you. And for those of us, maybe you've been Christian for years and we're struggling, you know the master of the wind. You know the maker of the rain. And he's there with you. If you have a need, you can come for prayer. I'll be down front. We have prayer partners all four corners of the building. And maybe today you say, you know what? I want to put my faith and trust in Jesus, be baptized in him. Whatever your need is, let's be standing. I'll pray. And we're going to sing, "There Was Another in the Fire Standing Next to Me." Father, you are so good. I thank you for allowing these men to record this for us so that we can know that peace doesn't happen outside. It happens inside when we know Jesus. And God, we struggle knowing Jesus sometimes. We're going to be honest, all of us. So for those who are going through some junk right now, God, be with them. Help them to know and to reach up to you and know Jesus is in the boat. And God, we thank you. And for those who don't know you, God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would just keep pestering them until they turn their lives over to you, because you are the true answer, in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't you come if you have a need this morning as we sing this song.
When the heart is under fire, another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need a reminder of how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden. Another died for me. There is another in the fire. So come and lay in the space between all the things I see and this reckoning.
Be seated. I'm going to ask Sharon to step up here a minute. This is Sharon Hanna, and you've seen her here for a couple of years. And Sharon and I go way back in the days in Paw Paw. Her dad was the one who baptized me when I was 9 years old. So yeah, isn't that cool, the connections? And when she started coming up here, I thought, this is cool. It's neat. She has family back there. Rob is her son, Rob Eaton. And so, you know, she has family. She has cousins over here, and so when she came up this way, moved up here, a natural thing for her to just want to be part of the church here. And so that's what she called and said, you know, she's a believer, a baptized believer in Christ, and she's saying, I just want to be part of Hope Christian Church and let the folks know it, because that way we can encourage. So we welcome her here today to be part of that church. And Sharon, I just ask you to repeat after me and everybody else who's a believer in here, if you would. I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the Living God.
The Son of the Living God.
My Lord.
My Lord.
And my Savior.
And my Savior.
All right. God bless you. Thank you. God is so good. And I hope that as Easter's growing close, we see what Jesus can do for us, especially when it comes to peace. Invite your friends, all right? Because we all need all the help we can get in this crazy, crazy world. So I'm going to turn it back over to Jason.
Yeah, and I'm going to turn it over to Rob, who is going to lead us in our communion devotional and meditation this morning. So if you haven't grabbed some of the communion elements, we have them on side tables and in the back, the little thing, because we're going to take communion together here in just a minute after we ask Rob to kind of lead us, lead our minds there, get us ready for that.
Good morning. Haven't spoke for a very long time, so bear with me. I'm not a professional speaker or anything. Never was good in English, so just bear with me. How many of us have ever had our back go out? My back went out on me this week. I went to bend over to pick up something in instant pain. Shot through the left side of my back. It literally put me on the floor. It brought tears to my eyes. It hurt so bad. It was such a scary feeling not being able to move my left leg. Long story short, we went to the ER, got some x-rays, and they determined it was sciatica. I got some medicine and some rest. I'm feeling a lot better now. Did you know that our back muscles are our main structural support for our bodies? These muscles help us move our bodies, including our head, our neck, our shoulders, our arms, and our legs. Our back muscles work together to support us. We come to this part of the hour to think about Jesus and all that he has done for us. Not only should we just think of him this hour, but through the rest of the week. We are all guilty of it. We don't think of him enough. But just like our backs, Jesus is our main support. He can hold us together as we move throughout our lives. The only difference is Jesus will not give out on us. He is always supporting us. Even if you feel like you have lost touch with him, guess what? You are the one that moved. He is always there waiting for us to talk to him. I was crying and whining just because my back hurt, and it did. But we will never have that pain that Jesus went through for our sins. So not only on this hour on Sunday should we think of him, but always throughout the rest of the week, and let him be our main structural support. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you right now, just knowing that none of us in this building are perfect. We love you, and we try to strive every day to be more like you. Just forgive us of our many sins and the way we fell short of you this week. Be with us as we go our separate ways this week and give us all safety. Be with our kids in the school. Wrap your loving arms around them. Give them the safety and the support that they need. Be with us at our jobs. Help us to be good examples to those we come in contact with every day. Just let us be a light into this community. We love you and we thank you. And we come now just thinking of you. Amen.